Hello, everyone. Hello, mate.
Yo, mate, how are you doing?
I'm good. First of all, I want to acknowledge you for getting this done. This is sick.
Got merch.
Thank you very much. We do have merch.
We do.
Nothing's for sale. Not yet, anyway. But I don't know. What do you think about this? I like it.
I do.
I really enjoy it. It's comfy. Nice little logo.
It's like Armani.
Yeah. Okay. So, we've had plenty of time to sleep, think, digest, and settle down. I don't know. Let's recap trade period. Not just for Carlton, but relative to the league as well. How do you, having sifted through the emotions and letting them subside, how do you feel?
I'm actually quite good with it. I think, I think at the point, and I think we all bought into, and the risk you run when you're Stephen Silvani and you're Agresta doing massive interviews and really having a trade strategy last year that said we were going hard at someone to this year, and then you've continually repeated that message, we're going hard, we're getting in recruits, key recruits, it's not a draft year.
Yep.
I think we all fell for it.
Yep.
And whether that was a bit of a ploy by Soss, I don't know.
Yep.
But I think the initial reaction is heartbreak. Mm. But I think looking at it, if we actually just summarise it, our 22 is three players better already.
Correct.
So we've got Charlie to come back,
yep.
Doc to come back, and we've got Betts, who is by far the best move forward. So I think it is a successful trade period.
Yeah. You mean it's a successful trade period from the point that we didn't get worse?
No, I mean,
so anytime you don't get worse and you don't give up too much, it's...
We got better, you know what I mean? Like I'd say, it's a hard C for me. If I was grading it, it's a hard C. It's better than average, C+.
Yeah. Obviously, if we go and end up getting Martin in through this preseason draft, I know that's the talk. I know that, you know, if that happens, great. Because we get him for nothing. The only thing I'm not going to do now with this Jack Martin preseason draft thing is I'm not going to take it as a given.
Nah, fuck it, just get on the,
just
get on
jump
the Jack
on.
Martin train.
Just jump on, you know.
No, I agree with you. There's a lot to play out. And we've got to remember there's a wary thing with his agent being public saying, oh, Melbourne have contacted us. We've said no.
Yep.
You can't do that. It's manipulation of the draft.
Yeah.
So if Melbourne do just go, you know what, screw it, Jack Martin, there's nothing Martin can do but retire.
Yeah, that's the other thing as well. You know, the AFL do make rules on the go. And technically by Jack Martin, it's smart by his manager and his people and by us, because Soss essentially called the bluff, right?
Yeah,
the bluff, and he said, well, we know that there's a mechanism, if you don't come to us now, and if we don't, you know, we're not going to trade you our pick 9 for Jack Martin and 15, we know that there is a mechanism to still get him through the preseason draft, which it's not illegal, but it's, you know, highly frowned upon and hasn't really been done before, and it could open the floodgates to something else.
Yeah, I think, because the last person to go through that who was high profile was Nick Stephen.
Okay.
But he nominated Collingwood and ended up at us.
Yeah.
So you've got to remember that they played it the right way. He nominated Collingwood. He said he would move to Victoria, though. It was very, like, papply situation.
Yep.
We took him in the draft.
Yep.
So there's the risk that's different between Stephen and this, that Carlton and Martin are both saying they won Carlton, where Stephen's party went quiet and were like, we hope to get to Victoria in the draft.
I think Luke Ball had a similar
There's been a few, but never been one, I'd say, historically, where the player has been so adamant he wants to go to one club.
Yeah.
Which then begs the question, if this happens, what about McGovern next year? McGovern's in the same situation. Imagine if he said, I want to go to West Coast at all costs.
Yeah.
We valued him, West Coast don't come to the party. He ended up manipulating the draft to get to West Coast. You're going to start to see a soccer situation happen where players dictate where they go, not the club. And that's the wonderful thing about this draft process.
Mm-hmm.
You can't get the deal. It's a lottery of where you go.
There's a way to get there. Players generally find their way. There's a lot of talk about sometimes not doing the deal is the right thing to do. The real test case for that for me, the first thing that came to mind was Golden State Warriors.
Yeah.
They were going to trade Clay Thompson for Kevin Love a few years back. And it was really close, and they ended up just holding firm and not doing the deal. And obviously, you know, I understand different sport, different mechanism, but, you know, what all we have right now is the positive. Like, we have to be positive about this moving forward. We can sit here and moan and groan about how shit and whatnot. I think the more the days go on, that all starts to go away. Because, like you said, it was a buy-in to a message. Now, they didn't say we're going to get them, but...
It alluded. Strategy.
You know, like... Don't, like, if Papley was really so reliant on the Danaher deal, then I just feel like the language coming out of our side just did not match that situation. Because if it was really always all about Danaher going to Sydney, then we should have knocked it on the head early.
It's something that confuses me, the language, though, because they did pretty much allude, the whole AFL world bought into nine was on offer and we didn't want to keep it.
Yeah.
Like, Soss's message now is the draft was always a backup plan.
Yeah.
So I kind of wonder why we didn't, at the start of the trade period, say, nine, we want a gun if we can get him.
Mm.
If we can't, though,
we're
more than happy with the talent that's in the draft available to us.
Yep.
Because then it puts a higher price on nine.
Yep.
I think when you're negotiating, because it's like, well, we're happy to keep it.
Yep.
You're going to have to make us an offer we can't refuse. Where it kind of came across that we were like, we will just throw nine at whatever comes.
Yep.
And I'm glad we didn't. Like, at the end of the day, that's made me happy doing the research for the draft. There is a lot of superstars, in my opinion, later on that we've got a really good punt at and could do well with. I mean, Gold Coast, though, shout out to them. I think Gold Coast, they played a good game. I think, personally, mentally, they see pick two as compensation for Jack Martin.
Mm-hmm.
So I think they did the right thing and said, let's see if we can get a first rounder for him.
Fair play to them.
Because at the end of the day, if they lose him for free, they've got pick two.
Yeah, that's
which
right.
Which is more than anyone will pay for Martin.
That's a very good point. On the draft, so I went back and listened to Agresta's interview.
Don't do it. It's a trap.
I went back and listened to Agresta's interview. He was at the draft combine, and that was the whole post about being, you know, we're prepared. The quotes in that video alluded to the fact that they felt like the draft was very deep, which goes against what the general consensus is. And it kind of does tie into what we have now. We've got quite a few picks after. We've got nine, and then what is it, 43, 50?
Yeah, we've got 43, and then one in the 50, a couple in the 50s, one in the 60s, 70s.
And the 70s. So if they always, and that's the thing, they always did feel like it was a deep draft, and maybe the strategy was, let's try and build these later picks because they feel like they can get a diamond in the rough. But, I mean, I'm not a list manager. I've got no idea what's going on, but I just, logically, I say to myself, geez, it's a bit risky relying on someone being available at pick, I don't know, 70.
I think probably there's an argument to that, but like if I had to rate this trade and draft how I feel at the moment, I'm 9 out of 10 positive, because I think the key thing is we've got Eddie Betts. Now, people might smirk when I say that, because even I do that, because I've been using that as a joke a lot.
Mm.
But we've got a free hit. So 43, there's some really good guys that are in the 40 to 60 category.
Yep.
D'Agostini is one, who is averaging 2.4 goals a game. Now, if you've got two small forwards at 18 years old, and you've got Eddie Betts, who is already working with the girls, he's showing he's keen to work.
Yep.
Imagine being 18 years old, raw talent. A couple of kids in that area have got raw talent.
Yep.
They know where the goals are. You are going to learn from probably the best small forward of the last decade.
True.
Now, it's a free hit.
If there's one thing he has been proven to do, it's really work with the younger talent wherever he has been to get the best out of them.
Yeah.
I felt like he did it with Jeffy Garland and Chris Yarran to an extent. I mean, the argument about Charlie Cameron's there as well, I could argue that he definitely helped his development as well. So there is that. And the other thing as well with Eddie Betts, I want to touch on, is the NGA program that Zach Dawson runs.
Yeah,
now, Eddie Betts has offered to help in that space as well. So there's a lot more value that's now coming, you know, to fruition with Eddie Betts in the fact that he's going to be able to identify that next bit of talent, but also that next generation of talent in those rural areas. They're going to want to work with Eddie Betts. He's the champion of the Indigenous community, maybe with Sean Burgoyne, you know?
I actually think this draft could be the most important draft count I'll ever have. I reckon, I've got a feeling in 10 years...
I say that every year.
I genuinely do, because this is an unexpected plan.
Yeah.
Like, no one expected it.
Yeah.
And we have got nine, so nine is the key to all this.
You have to nail it. There's no ifs or buts about it.
And if you look at the top 10, there is a great argument outside the clear top two, which are Raoul and Anderson. There is a great argument from 3 to about 12, that any club could pick anyone. There's a great argument to be had.
Mm.
Like, and also there's this talk about Liam Henry, he's an absolute jet.
Yeah.
Carlton will have to put a bid on him. Now, will Frio match it? You'd presume they would do, but there's a lot to play out. Like I was saying earlier, if I was Gold Coast, I would pick one, Adam Green, and throw Gold GWS. And be like, do you dare match it? Because that will throw the draft into even more chaos.
Right.
Because Green is more what they want. He's a Cripps clone.
Okay.
He's a big unit of a midfielder.
Yep.
And Raoul and Anderson's very samesy.
Mm-hmm.
I'd be doing that, like throwing the draft into chaos.
Take me through the process because when I went, I've only watched one under-18s championship game this season. Well, one day I watched the finals.
Yeah, you were there for the carnival. Tight, right?
And Liam Henry, he stood out clearly stood out. I remember talking to you about him, and you were being like, "Yeah, I know about him." Talk to me about what is the situation there. What's the process? What does Freo have, and what is it going to take to get someone like him?
Yeah, so Freo have got the pick directly after us.
So pick 10.
So if we bid 9, they'd have to throw away 10, and they'd lose. That'd be their pick.
I don't get it. So we bid for Henry. They say, no, we're going to actually...
Yeah, they'd have to match it on points.
Because he's part of their national... Next Gen Academy.
Next Gen Academy.
So that means, what would we end up doing with 9 if we didn't
get... We just get 10 then, effectively. They're like, 9's burned because Freo will probably do 10 and give away their last pick to match the points.
What are the chances of that happening?
It's a tough one because Irvin Mosquito last year was the highest rated player out of Hawthorn's academy.
Yeah.
Essendon threw the curveball, picking him 15 picks earlier than expected.
Okay.
And Hawthorn were like, well, we've got a bit of business we want to do with this pick.
Yep.
Now, Henry is kind of falls in the 8 to 20 range. If you look at all the drafts,
yep.
There's a lot of conjecture where he falls.
Yep.
There is a chance, there always is a chance that we pick 9 and Fremantle will think, well, nah. Because there is a stigma, players don't bid on NGA. There's kind of an unwritten rule, teams don't really do it.
Mm-hmm.
And even when at the draft, when an Essendon bid on Mosquito, the commentators were like, oh, it's a little bit, like, for me, uncalled for.
Yeah.
It's kind of, well, instead of being nice, why don't we be a bit of a dickhead this draft? Because Henry, Indigenous player, guarantee him with bets, and he is X factor. Like,
yeah,
forget. Man. Forget about X Factor of Papley.
The guy is a serious talent. I remember watching him, and it was just some players have that ability that every time they're near the ball or get the ball, like
he makes stuff up.
Everything stops, and you're just in awe of him. And that was for me that from the first moment I saw him, not having watched a single minute of the under-18s season, none of it, he really stood out to me.
He reminds me of Liam Ryan. I'd say that's probably the closest description in the comp at the moment.
Yep.
He's like that type of player. He's that player that just has the ability to make magic happen.
Yep.
And learning from Betts, mm-hmm. like, we'd forget. I guarantee if we get Henry by round 3, you'd be like, Papley who?
No, mate, I'm going to be...
You'd be Papley who?
Mate, we're still talking about Dylan Shield and Cornelio.
Yeah,
Papley for me, and I said this yesterday in the video. Papley was the ticket. It was the hope. But the thing that I've now come to realise is that we, as Carlton supporters, we always champion individuals. It's just what we do. And maybe it's a blessing in disguise that we didn't get him right now, because maybe, you know, we're talking about him being the difference between us making finals and not, and this and that.
There's something to be said, though, about building your list.
Yeah.
Like, how much sweeter will it be if we don't do a Geelong and go out and buy Tom? We build it from within. That's how you create dynasties. You don't create dynasties by buying players.
True.
You create dynasties by making it internally, and we're doing that. Like, I'm still confident we'll finish top 12.
Mm. Mark Pitonet, for me, it was good. Phillips was coming to a point where he, prime of his life, prime of his athletic career as a ruckman, will be attracting more money. Pitonet still got to prove himself. He's hungry. I actually love it for Tom. For Tom DeConing, because he's now worked with Cruiser, Lobe, Phillips. Pitonet comes in as like the new guy who's going to want to prove himself. So rest assured, you are going to be coming up against a hungry guy at training. And it's going to force Tom to really, you know, learn the trade from another ruckman who was, you know, one of the better ruckmen in the VFL this season, if not the best. So from that point of view, I'm excited for Tom. Pitonet speaks really well. And the guys from the Ian Prendergast, I was listening to it on the way here, they made a really good point relating it to the NFL. You know, it's the second string quarterback that's the most important person for your future, because there's so many of them that are fighting for that backup spot because they're the future. Now, Tom and Mark are going to fight it out. So there's a tick there. Also, when they do play in the VFL, there's two of them, not three ruckmen in the team. So
helps.
More ruck work, more pressure on them to perform, forward time. They've got to, you know, impact as well. So, you know, I see it as a... And then, when you know, we know Cruiser is just going to miss games. His body dictates that. So when that does happen, and he has a bit of a rest and they manage his load, and whoever plays Pitonet or DeConing, whoever's in the VFL is going to get a full crack at it. So I do like it from that point of view.
Yeah, and I also think there's an argument to be had that the top teams at the moment are using two ruckmen.
Yep.
This whole idea of no third man up was to try and put pressure on ruckmen. Ruckmen could do the game on their own. One ruckman with a nomination. And a lot of the teams are breaking that trend. West Coast played with two.
Mm-hmm.
Richmond played with two. Mm-hmm. All the top teams are starting to do with two. And TDK fits that mould because he's also very efficient with his athleticism up top as well.
Mm-hmm.
So you could see that maybe Carlton's strategy as well is long-term. We have that ability now because Pitney will be the stay-at-home ruckman. He's very versatile himself. He's probably not as athletic by no means as TDK is, but it gives us that option that TDK can play that Scott Lysett role of smashing the ruck, going up top and creating a bit of damage.
Yep.
Pitney, very reliable, very good tap ruckman as well. So like we've got to remember that Pitney is basically Phillips 5 years ago.
Pitonet.
Yeah, well,
Pitonet.
He's French, so he gets no respect from me.
He's actually Italian.
With the worst Italian
name. We're one of the worst Italian names there. Oh, so those $10,000 worth of espressos that we had fucking sitting there for Cornelio.
They're all in the background, so they might as well.
Yeah.
He's Italian.
Yeah, he's Italian, yeah. I was listening to him yesterday. He's got Italian heritage.
Are you sure he's not colourblind and he's looked at the flag and assumed it's Italian?
I'm telling you, he's Italian. He's got a good character to him as well. So that's that. What it also does is... I've heard the argument, you know, North Melbourne, Fremantle, St Kilda have all, you know, the teams that are kind of there or thereabouts around us have all improved their list through the trade period. And, you know, yeah, some people think we haven't in terms of bringing in 3, 4, 5 players. There is an argument to be made, though, that maybe we have better players coming up than what they do. And it also puts a bit of pressure on the current list to really break through. So I'm looking at Fisher, Dow, Petrovsky, Seaton, Lockie O'Brien, like they have to come from there now. That's they've got the games into them now. Now they start entering their third and fourth preseason. Like it has to happen. Who's it gonna be?
I think the key for me, and I think is Gibbons. I've got a feeling about Gibbons. If you look at him statistically in the last six games of the year.
Yeah.
He was actually, if you use that and pro-rata it for a whole season, he was better than Papley.
Yeah. Well,
I'm not joking.
Wow.
I'm not joking. He was better. You look at his goals and the numbers, he was up there with Papley.
Yeah.
And he's a natural footballer. He is a natural football nouse. And he was owning that half-forward flank role.
Yeah.
He was really starting to come. So I actually think internally we've got the players we're linked with. Like, Jack Martin is the cherry on the cake.
Yeah.
But to me... He suits Fisher's role, unfulfilled talent. He's probably not someone that we really desperately need.
Yeah.
He's X factor, which Fisher probably hasn't got.
Yeah.
But for me, I can see Gibbons being really focal. I think Gibbons working with Betts, I actually do truly believe that Papley's no big loss to Carlton Football Club.
I like it. The other thing as well with breakout candidates is generally you've got to see something in the back end of the year before to suggest that there's a break. Like I didn't see anything in the back end of 2019 from Fisher to suggest he's going to break out. Gibbons is a good test case there because he actually played better as the season wore on. And like you said, the last 6, 7, 8 weeks, whatever it was, he was really prominent. So for me, Gibbons candidate to break out. Not break out, but you know, really improve next year. Jacob Wiedering showed a lot in the back half of the year. So again, that's why I've got him as one of my key breakout targets. And if I'm using that logic, I didn't see signs from Paddy Dow just yet. But Lockie O'Brien definitely showed good signs towards the back end of the year. I'm mindful of just this hope. You know, Papley for me was a sure thing, but maybe there isn't a sure thing. But the hope that one of these or two of these guys break through is what I'm... and I guess the end of the day, I said it yesterday, you've got to have faith in the list management. Like, they've drafted these kids for a reason, and we're really going to see which one of them are going to make it and which one of them are going to be worth where they were picked. 2020, 2021, 2022. It's make or break.
You've definitely got to George Michael this and have a lot of faith. You definitely have.
Yeah.
But, like, for me, I just... Like, honestly, I was angry at the time, and I've gone, like, full circle. Maybe I've got bipolar disorder or something.
Yeah.
But I was, like, livid at the point, woke up, fresh as a daisy. Like, I don't see the problem. I think at the end of last year, from round 12 to 23, everyone was like, if the season went on 5 more games, we'll make the 8.
Yep.
Like, statistically we did. We were, what, top six in the league? Mm-hmm. Based from round 12, we were one of the better sides. That's only got better.
Yep.
Like, the team then to now is better. You've got Betts.
You've got Betts.
Like, and to me, that's a huge thing. And I think Betts is going to help Dow. He's going to help Fisher.
Yeah.
Purely because you look at how Dow enters 50.
Yeah.
It's the old throw it on the boot, flat trajectory.
Yeah.
That is what Betts feeds off. Them spillages.
That's true.
That's Betts' bread and butter. So for me, I just don't see it. For me, I still think we're top 12. I can't see how Papley... I think Papley would have propelled us into the eight.
Yeah.
But I also think of it logically, Gibbons was just as good towards the back end of the year.
Yeah.
Also, Papley is probably the most flawed signing. A big negative with Betts was two good games. He got 30 goals, six in each.
Yeah.
That was the biggest counter-argument. Big counter-argument for Papley is he went missing most of the games.
Mm.
He had a great start of the year, and then the back end of the year, he was rubbish. He got a haircut and was pants. So let's be honest, like, Gibbons to me was reliable. He showed it from round one, all them shots at goal, never scored.
Yeah.
But he showed willingness. He learnt the role. For me, I don't see it. You go into this draft, you get a goal, you get a Will Gold.
Yep.
You somehow get Cody Waitman's there, who's, in my opinion, will be a lot better than Papley's ever thought about being.
Yeah, yeah.
He's brilliant. And his negative is engine. Mm-hmm. We've got the best engine maker in the comp.
True.
In Russell.
True.
So as you say, you get Waitman in this draft, you go out, get D'Agostini, you maybe get Ben Sokol, three goals in Waffle on average. It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
Mature age. Going to get a second chance. You could go that route. Maybe Blakey from the Northern Blues, maybe Jake and Quirk.
Yep.
As well as a little project player. Don't see the problem. Carlton, yeah. I mean, I'm still adamant Carlton will win a flag 2021. Nothing's told me that it ain't. I actually think that's a lock.
Love it. I feel like we've probably got to make the finals next year to win the flag the year after. Because, I mean, finals is a different game.
I actually just think that we'll make the A and then we'll win it.
I
reckon the first time we make finals, we'll win.
Mm. Well, I hope for a lot of things.
I hope for a lot of things. The only thing that I watched the video back after, the one thing that I agree with is we're Carlton Football Club.
Yep.
Right? And it was passion. And let's bring that back. Who gives a shit? We ain't get Papley. Papley plays for Sydney.
True.
Like, no one goes to Sydney unless you're having an affair. There is no reason to go to Sydney. It's too expensive. You don't. It's where you book a hotel. Right? So let's be honest. Carlton Football Club, we'll be back. And why don't we do it in a way we've never done it before?
Yeah.
Instead of buying players like we did, you know, that shady past everyone says.
Yeah, go and get the big fish.
Let's just do it with our own. Because I'll tell you what, Fisher, Dow, they're going to have big years this year. That's a guarantee. They've got talent.
Is it a guarantee?
It is a guarantee. Why is it not? Like, for me, they...
I'm not saying they're not capable, but it's just more...
The style that we play now,
under
Bolton, like to me, let's forget about the negativity of Sauce. Like,
yeah.
Let's just throw that away.
Yeah.
Right?
Shouldn't be there, but yeah.
Bolton made us play the most dire brand of football in AFL history. It was like Malthouse levels of dire.
Yeah.
Right? We've got an exciting coach. Teague plays exciting football. The kids love him. Betts is here.
Yeah.
Come on, boys, get up and about. We're going to make the eight.
What's the patience levels with Teague? Like, how long do you give him?
I think we'll hit the ground running. We hit the ground running.
Yeah, but like, I do too. Don't get me wrong, but like, knowing what's happened with, because knowing we feel like the list is so, you know, has so much potential.
We go 0-4, I guarantee that we face what groups going TGL.
That's what I'm saying, like, what's, like, you've got to give him a chance. We gave Bolton, what, 2.5? 3?
We gave him, like, what, forever, didn't we? Like, there's still people now who go, we shouldn't get rid of Bolton.
Yeah.
Like, there is still mad people there, like, clinically mad.
Yeah, well, he did give us a good term. Equilibrium,
he did give us that. Green shoots. Yeah.
No, but like, so I think Teague's got a big give, like, going into the year, you've got to give him 2. Because, and the reason why I say 2 and not 3 or 4 or 5 is because the mandate and the message from the club is, like, the coach that we pick has got to be hitting the ground running. It's time to win now.
I reckon he's got to the bye.
Well, I'll tell you what,
We're fans. I reckon
it's
not so
the bye. The reality, that goes to my next point. Great. 2 years, patience, good. If we're fucking 1-10 next year, rest assured, we've got to be a like, do we panic? Like, what happens? I don't want to think too negatively, but I think we've got to be a little, like, I stuffed up with Bolton, like, waiting too long. I was like, no, this is going to be fine. It's all going to turn. But you can't wait. Cripps is out of contract end of 2021. So like there is a bit of pressure to keep him and make sure we put a good environment around him. I just want to get your thoughts on how long you think David Teague, well, what's the patience? What's the meter?
My personal one? Or
yeah.
Like,
yeah, your personal one.
I haven't thought of it because I haven't prepared for him to fail.
Yeah. Nor have I.
I mean, I didn't
prepare for Bolton to fail either, mate. But I got fucking green shoots for 3 years, so.
Oh, 2018, if you weren't at the bar sucking, what were you doing with your lives? Watch football. But, like, for me, I think, me personally, I'm looking at seeing progression in the terms of more of last year.
Yep.
If it's more of last year all the way through and we go, say, 8 and 12, but it's performances like last year, I'll be happy.
Yep.
Because last year, under Teague, we were always in games. There was never games where we were scratching to hope.
True,
probably
true.
The Geelong game would be the exception.
Correct.
But aside from that, we were always in games, always looked like we were going to have a go,
yep.
Always looked like the aim was to win, not damage limitation.
Yeah, it's true.
And I think the more he plays that style of football, the more success will follow it.
Yep.
I reckon with the fans, though, because there is probably, I'd say every club has 20% nuffies, we have 25. And
yeah,
I'd say then 5% will come out if at the bye counting a 2 and say 8 and St Kilda a 6-2 and everyone will be like, should have got Rattan because like
Rattan was the choice.
Rattan had the best squad we've had in 20 years and he scraped in by cheating for the top 8.
Yeah.
Like, and it'll be madness. And it'll be like, to me, Rattan wouldn't coach Carlton, shouldn't coach Carlton. We've done the right thing. I think Teague needs minimum of a year,
okay.
And it has to be on how we perform, because
yep.
We saw Brisbane as a model. They've kept every game close the year
yep.
before last, and then look what happened.
True.
It was that thing. So you've got to remember we've got to blood Teague's game plan in.
That's true.
And I think it's going
to
be good.
I want to turn to the fans. Jeff O'Day. Jeff, we're finally addressing this. So he sent me, and if you haven't checked this out, go and check out, Jeff has set up a page, I think it's Carlton Football Club 2020 Membership Drive.
Yeah.
I had a really good conversation with him and he sent us some emails. The premise of the discussion was this. It was, you know, we've had the Tiger Army, the Magpie Army, and his thing was like, do we really want to be, because like, we're going to be coming up, you know, we're looking at 70, 75,000 members. The question was, do we want to be labelled as the, you know, the Navy Blue Army? Jeff was of the opinion that he didn't want to sort of continue on that route. It was more, as a membership drive, let's try and be something like the Navy Blue Ocean, the wave of Navy Blue. I kind of like it.
I see where he's going. I mean, I've never liked the phrase baggers.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
As a Pommy, that means you're a bit of a moaner. Which is
yep.
ironic, a Pom saying it.
Yeah.
But like, yeah, it doesn't have the same connotation. Like when we've got like firms, like the Millwall firm.
Yeah.
You know, like, and it sounds hard.
Yeah.
Like
the Navy. And it's true because the way that we support, it's like a wave, it's a sea of Navy Blue.
It's deep as well.
Yeah, I kind of like it.
Dangerous.
Yeah, and it separates us from the whole Army, because Army, you can have a bit of a ruggedy sort of rough look to it, you know, the Army, you know, you've got the Bay 13 tricksters, you know what I mean?
I genuinely, though, do miss the old putting a glass bottle over someone's head in those heads. We are too nice as football fans, but no, Jeff, I tell you what, like I said, 25% of Carlton fans enough is. What we do make up for, though, is the 75% of very knowledgeable, intelligent, wonderful people
yeah.
and watch this show.
Yeah.
So, like, for me, yeah, I think maybe I do think we need to be branded better. I mean, the cheer squad for me do a wonderful job, and I'd like them to have a bit more influence in driving that
yeah.
club culture home.
If there's one thing that we do as a club, is we operate with our fans pretty well, and the cheer squad, I've come to learn about some of their work and how they work with the club, how they operate with the club. We're very open and receptive. I mean, obviously, they allow us to, you know, interview players as well, for example. But I want to touch on the cheer squad, because I meant what I said last time about, like, I reckon they definitely had a part to play with Eddie Betts. I remember reading and watching things when Eddie first left and seeing how he would go to the cheer squad and take the selfies and they'd embrace him and he would embrace them. Like, it could have very much been something that we turned on with Eddie Betts. led by the cheer squad, they could have booed him and whatnot. And I can't help but feel like Eddie knew he would have been loved coming back.
Oh, 100%.
And I feel like they've played a very important part there.
Yeah, well, I mean, I read some comment the other day, someone had posted that Carlton's cheer squad were, it was an actual Carlton fan in a group, and he'd said that the cheer squad were useless, we need to change it, they stick two fingers up at players, abuse the umpire. And I was reading it thinking, no wonder Australia's going down the shithole if men like that are becoming that soft. Because, like, to me, that's the cheer squad's meant to be pro Carlton.
That's what you're meant to be doing.
Fancy thing. Like, to me, the cheer squad do a wonderful job. Yeah. I mean, everyone I've met from the cheer squad and spoken to, knowledgeable fans, passionate, their heart's in the right place.
Yeah.
Like, and Nick as well, like, he's been on our show.
One of the leaders,
seems like one of the most wonderful guys and human beings around. So for me, like, that's not stupid. Like, Eddie Betts said that the culture and the fans are why he came back. It's always been home. And who drives our fan-based culture?
Yep.
It's the cheer squad. It's what you always know. Like, you think Collingwood, you think Joffa, Carlton, you think our cheer squad,
don't you?
And, like, for me, brilliant. Like,
even I tell you what, the cheer squad have got to put a big pre-season in as well, because games are going to get electric now. We need new chants. We need a whole, you know, we need to evolve as well. And I'm looking forward to seeing how that happens with the fan base through the cheer squad.
Like I said last week, Betts is worth 50 goals to me, not from his own boot, but from how he gets the crowd going.
Yep.
And that relationship between Betts and the cheer squad will be fundamental.
Absolutely.
Because the way that Betts gets in the face of the cheer squad, gets them pumped.
Yep, yep.
I mean, when he kicks them goals from the pocket, can you imagine the noise from the cheer squad?
All he's got to do is kick one of those goals in round one, those magical
does
Eddie Betts goals.
Does that beautiful little grin he does, you know, where that little laugh he does, where as if I did it again.
I got goosebumps, mate. I got goosebumps.
I can see it. And I can see him just pointing to the cheer squad, them going mental.
Yeah.
And suddenly, like, Lockie O'Brien will lift.
Yeah.
Dow will lift.
That's the other thing as well. One thing I didn't touch on before when you were talking about Eddie was, for a guy like, you know, Dow, who's low on confidence, he's got that ability to put his arm around his shoulder and be like, it's okay, because he's got that infectious energy. So that's another important component to this as well.
And I think one person who's going to be a breakout this year is McGovern.
Mitchie?
With Betts.
Yeah.
Because he was super stoked he's back.
Yes.
If you look at highlights from 2017, they linked up superbly well.
Yep.
I think it's going to be an exciting time. I can actually see McGovern and Betts. I wouldn't mind wondering what the odds are on them being 1-2 in our goal kickers.
Yeah, well, the thing is with them, and this is the other positive about the two of them, I know that people can be focusing on the fact that McGovern was out of shape and whatnot. He was injured, by the way. But they understand and know the Teague system very well. They played, both of them, played their best footy of their careers to date under the David Teague system, the attacking system. So I picture they're not, like, I felt like, and it was hard because Charlie was injured or Harry was out or Mitch was hurt, so they didn't really get to gel. Now you've got Betts and Mitch there together. They know the system. And David Teague spoke a lot about this year in press conferences about how Mitch plays his role for the team. And I thought that was conducive to the forward system, right? So really excited for that as well. Definitely.
I think the problem with Carlton every season up until now, is we haven't had someone who knows what to do when the ball hits the deck from the tall forwards.
Yeah, yeah.
And to me, you watch Eddie, like last year, how clever he is. He's hanging out the back of the forwards, knowing it's going to go over the top of them. And that's something that you can teach. Positioning and things like that. He uses his body well. There's a great goal against Jeremy McGovern against West Coast where he out-muscles McGovern. He just leans into him and then peels off, loses his balance, and Betts uses his pace.
Yep.
Things like that, that's going to make Cunningham better and stuff like that. And one thing that McGovern does well is, if you look at that last year Teague did, they say it takes 2 years for a plan to take effect in sport. The second year, Betts kicked just short of 80, and McGovern had his best goal kicking year.
Yep.
So to me, think about it logically, this is the second year. But Betts already knows the forward structure.
Yep.
McGovern does. I expect huge things from them two next year.
Yep.
And that's why I'm confident Carlton will be top 12 next year.
Absolutely. Who else were the bigger... what are some of the movements that happened during trade week that sort of caught your eye?
Melbourne's pick eight.
Yeah.
That worried me a little bit.
Why?
Because I know they're in the market for a small. They've been active with it, Jamie Elliott.
Yep.
And Cody Waitman fits the bill, and it means they're just one ahead of us.
Yep.
Which I'd be very surprised they don't take him.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it depends who they take. If they take Sarong with four,
good player,
they might just suddenly think, well, you know what, we've got him. Kind of puts that in doubt. I was impressed with that one. I was impressed, I've got to say, I was impressed with Sydney's trade period in the terms of with the Danaher.
Yeah.
That they didn't fall into Essendon's trap. I mean, it's unbelievable they wanted two first and Heaney. Quality banter.
That's banter.
Essendon, I've got to say, I know Carlton fans are hating Essendon at the moment.
Yeah.
Go admit, it was hilarious. Like, if we... Listen. Like, because it makes me think, what's Betts worth? I mean, what's Cripps worth?
Yeah, listen, if I'm an Essendon fan, Dodoro did exactly what he was meant to do. Did his job to a T. We don't know what the actual offer was because both of them are saying conflicting things, but Dodoro saying that pick five was never on the table. Pick five and nine was never on the table. Sydney are saying it was, so...
If five and Carlton's nine was on the table, which I reckon it will have been, because speaking to Soss, he's saying that nine was part of the negotiations for Danaher.
Yeah.
So they'd taken it.
Yeah.
So let's be honest, if it's five and nine, if I was Essendon, I'd be pissed, because them two top 10 picks for Danaher?
Is there a replacement for Danaher with five and nine in the draft that you can get? Because a lot of the conversation was about... Sometimes you've got to look at the draft picks relative to who's in that draft.
I don't think there was that would be ready now.
Yeah, okay.
I don't think they'd be ready now, but I think, for me, five and nine could have got a lot of their problems sorted.
Yep.
And I reckon when you've got five and nine, you could have looked at, you know, like, look at some of the players that are out there that are not playing, like Josh Bruce.
Yeah.
He might have been a player that I would have maybe thought of going for a year.
Fill the gap, yeah.
I mean, you could have also made an argument for...
Jenkins.
Mm. Do you know what I mean? You could have made an argument for... Like, you know, the fact that they've got Phillips in.
Yeah.
You know, plonk him there at centre-half forward. Cale Hooker does a job down there.
Yeah.
And up top. Like, you could have made an argument of them two picks are so valuable.
Yeah.
That you could have just sacrificed this year. Because I reckon without Danaher, they did it last year and made the eight without Danaher.
Yeah, that's right.
They could do it again.
Absolutely. So, yeah, look, fair play to them.
But for me, best trade period was St Kilda.
St Kilda.
I was impressed with Saints.
Yeah, look, they do what they need to do. I didn't mind Geelong. I didn't mind what they did. I thought that was solid in terms of the picks they've got now. They've got a team that's going to contend next year. They'll be there or thereabouts. And I had a look at the draft picks. They've got like, I could be wrong on this, but it's like 17, 19, and then there's one that's 20.
They've got some decent picks.
So there's that. Richmond have plenty of picks too.
Richmond, yeah. I mean, you know they're going to do something spectacular. They always do.
So
I thought Gold Coast had a very good trade period as well.
Of course they did, mate.
No, I mean, they've got a lot, but I think the players they brought in, I think Ellis is a fantastic guy. I think Greenwood is a brilliant player.
I rate him.
I think they're going to be okay.
Yeah.
I also was impressed with West Coast.
Yep.
The fact there was no fannying around with Kelly. They just got the job done.
Yeah, well, that's Geelong for you, though.
Yeah,
so, though, again, I was listening to the Ian Prendergast. I was talking about Stephen Wiles at Geelong. He doesn't fluff around. It's not about stroking the ego. So the reference point was Lockie Henderson. So we got a first-round pick for him, which obviously now we win that. But at the time, that's what they needed. Stephen Wiles was like, right, let's just get it done. And fair play to Geelong this year. They got Tim Kelly done early. It allowed them time to do more negotiating and to sort of test out and see what happens
as well. Yeah. But, I mean, I admire both their list managers that they identified the talent and just went, let's do it.
Yeah, so fair play to Geelong. Well done.
Because that could have dragged out. Like, that had dragged out all day because Geelong was saying three first rounders and Dustin.
Yeah, there
Martin.
Could have been a bit of, you know, chest pumping.
But I thought it was a fair deal for both parties. Because to me, I hate the phrase, it's overs.
Yeah.
Because at the end of the day, everything is only its value to the buyer.
Yeah, what you need is what you need. Go and pay.
So do you know what I mean? Like, you might think nines are overrated for Papley. If you're desperate for a Papley, nines is a bargain.
Yeah, so Papley's still going to be available next year. Who else? What are we forecasting for 12 months' time? We've already spoken about Whitfield and one of these GWS boys. But again, should we stop doing this? Should we stop forecasting, bringing in, you know, because this time next year we need to be for real as a team?
For me, I think this year, depending on how Cunningham goes, I think Cunningham's got the potential to be a Papley as well. Like, you look at how good he was in the pre-season, he was probably the best small forward in the competition in the JLT by a mile.
Yeah.
He was just banging.
He looks solid.
So to me, this time next year, I'd say probably who I'd be looking at, Zach Williams from GWS, the halfback flanker.
Oh, because we need the replacement from Simo. Yep.
I would say, depends what we do in the draft, though. There's some very good halfback flankers in the top 10, top 20.
Okay.
That we could look at. But to me, that's what I do.
Mm.
Like, but I reckon, I'm going to have a little sneaky thing. We'll play this back. So hi Dan, September 2020. I don't reckon we'll need anyone.
I like it.
I reckon this time next year we'll be looking at depth and we'll be building what Richmond have.
Yep.
A-grade talent, well not A-grade, good AFL players to come off the pine should have injuries.
Next year as well, we probably start to... at what point does the depth become too much to the point where clubs are coming to us? Like we heard a little bit of noise about Zach Fisher. We heard, you know, so when does that start? When do we start becoming the GWS factory?
When we're top four.
Yeah, yeah, fair enough.
At the moment, we can't afford to split fair the group enough. Up unless we're guaranteed to make it better.
Yep. Yeah, fair point. Fair point. All right, mate. Always a pleasure.
That was a pleasure.
Go the Mighty Blues.